play Flightner, and I can get up to 7 levels of lift in about 25 minutes. All right.
Open air.
So, what was that?
Open air.
I use Bali Wrap.
Okay.
This is this little tool that I have here. So what's nice about this is it's already perforated. Wrinkle it. You can unravel it. It's really nice. It's awesome. I'm a little bit like a control freak, I guess. I like to keep my sections nice and clean, especially if I'm also doing painting underneath it. I just don't want to touch anything. I'm just like that. So the reason why too you can get so light is because the product is really thick. All right. It's like cream cheese. Okay. With this one, you don't want to use it on your hand. So I'm just gonna mix it a little bit less. Just got there for a second, but I do use a paddle. It keeps it nice and clean. So. So usually I kind of go a little bit diagonal back. And then also too, I usually start in the back. You can also, I get asked this question a lot, doesn't it process a lot faster in the front? Well, I do use 40 volume. I do use a bond builder. This is a clay lightener. But you can also control what your volume is by one bowl of lightener. So everyone knows, the powers in the lightener, also your saturation, your sweeps. So if someone had blonde hair, I might go to a 30. I mean, I mix every 20 minutes too to keep it nice and fresh. But I'm not gonna load it on someone who has blonde hair. I might just use a less pressure and then do a little bit more saturation, heavier saturation on the face, so it all balances out and comes out the same. So this technique I'm also gonna do is, it's gonna help frame her face. If anyone sees, has darker on the top, and you have a really nice that money piece flaring out there. That's also nice. So stick a little bit more under here because I need a really heavy. Product, and I'm going to sweep it on one side here like this. Make it nice and flat. The product is thick, so that's why we use the paddle as well. So, this is my balayage brush. It's very stiff, it's good saturation. You paint a little bit differently by kind of tapping in little seam motions to really build that product up there. That saturation is going to get you really light. I don't have all day at the salon, I don't have an assistant right now. That helps me. So, I mean, usually at most, start to finish with the haircut and styling is about 2 hours and 45 minutes, 3 hours for start to end total body client. So, kind of gives you a little. Now, with this client here, since this is so small of a section, I'm just going to actually take this whole section. If they had a really wide area to work with, I would actually divide that up. I would start with this section and go lower, and then start with this section and go higher around the face, but I'm just going to take this whole section because it is a pretty small section. Now, a lot of clients too, or stylists too, have a lot of trouble with spottiness, unevenness. One of the big things is tension. Tension is key, especially with this product because it is so thick. You don't want to go down here and start painting on here, because you're going to have all that give right there, and the heavy part is just going to seep in, get banding, it's going to bruise in the middle. So when I do this, you want to hold your fingers about 2 to 3 inches away from where you are going to paint. So kind of just take a little bit of product, line it up like this. So around the face. Depending on on, of course, how close they want it to the, you know, the hairline. You can either go, feel like that a little bit of root look, you don't have to go as close. So what I'm gonna do is do it heavier more on the sides. And then what I'm gonna do is, I'm just gonna kind of blend that lightly, because everybody knows around the hairline you have those little baby hairs. Just to add a little bit more brightness, I'm just gonna not use as much pressure. So it's still gonna give you brightness, but it's not gonna be as bold as those pieces. Sometimes I change it up a little bit. I'm always standing away. It's kind of moving my elbow out. A lot of people paint inward. I just feel like sometimes they lose the pressure. You basically want the lighter to do the talking for you. So you technically don't want to hear the bristles on the hair unless you're like really like blending or just sweeping here. You want to just have that light hair kind of do the talking. Because look at that heavy saturation right there. That's going to give you the most lift, right? So I start to keep working my fingers all the way down. So I'm going to show you a neat trick that, I mean, you shouldn't really show your clients this, but I'm going to show you of how this would appear once it's going to lay downward. Because a lot of people, I feel like they don't go back. I mean, I do both. I go down, and then I also go away. So I will just show you what this will look like. Corner to corner, usually. I'm just kind of dusting those ends. I want to kind of get underneath. Kind of push a little bit more. I want to make sure I go up and check my section. And then I usually place it going back. So now I'm going to show you what this looks like when this would be actually falling down on your face. So you see that? Dark on top of the light, it's going to make that blonde kind of pop out. I do the back first.
Oh, okay.
I do all the back first, so this is already has a piece of molly wrap on top of it, so I'm just pacing right over top of that molly wrap. So now I'm gonna start, I mean, there's so many different ways, kind of what I'm feeling, what I'm gonna do. So then I might go more downward with this one. So then if I wanna go back away from the face again, I don't want to put one right here because I don't want to have this huge big chunk of clump right here.
Yeah.
So I want to start a little bit early. There's sometimes where, like if I'm just taking a diagonal back, I can do that the whole way up. So what I'll just do is, like I said before, I'll just split those sections up. And then this one, I'm going to go a little bit lower because, like I said before, if you place a light on top of the dark, it kind of makes it pop more. Or, I mean, if you just want a higher up look with the highlight, you can go higher up. Kind of whatever I'm feeling. Show you a cool tip on how to really tip out those ends as well, which is also called pancaking. So what I'll do is I'll take the brush, kind of go over, and then I'll get the back here. So it's really going to ice out those ends. Thank you. really not bruising into the hair. I'm letting the product do the talking. Usually, with this lightener, I usually mix it 1:1. And I usually always measure, because the consistency can get a little funky if you're used to, kind of used to how you like your mixture color and everything like that, or your regular lighteners. Also with this product, if it ever gets too shiny, you just want to add a little bit more powder to it. And also, if I do have a dark client, I can get them really light. Like I said, I can get 7 levels of lip. So what I'll do is I'll mix 1 ounce of the powder to 0.85 of the developer. It's just a little bit harder to paint, but I can get them light. So this is kind of like my thing, my niche.
I love it.
To do this technique, because basically you're surface painting, so basically all underneath it would still be orange. Mm. So if that, I don't really like to do a lot of it, but I had more control over it. So I did make the ultimate decision of doing that way.
Yeah.
There was I had a couple of them. There was a before and after.
Oh.
Wow, I love your work.
Yeah, isn't it gorgeous?
You have so much dimension in your photos.
Yes.
And
do you feel like creating those saturated creates the ribboning effect?
So usually I take a crochet pattern, which is like a V.
So
if you do a higher up from the V and you go down and have a meet, you're going to get those bands in the hair. So that's why
you see
a lot. April 27th. So you can kind of just show everybody. That was when I did like a more of a teasy light action. That took me, I think, 4 hours, I think?
That would take me 4 days.
Yeah.
That's
gorgeous.
Do a lot of girls find you on Instagram?
Yes. I even had a class that came to me recently. I had a group of 14, and I had like four. Now I'm a PA. I had four from Maryland, one from Chicago, one from Indiana. Those are the furthest. Male, feminine, on Instagram. Social media is huge.
Yeah.
Well, like you were saying, a lot of geolocations, you know what I mean? But I think, you know, it just shows people are willing to travel.
Your engagement on your photos is amazing.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Beautiful. I am in a couple of engagement groups
okay.
on Instagram. They're just like a regular group message. They are like 15 and max group. So that will also help you if you just kind of, we can make a vocal wall of us and we can always comment.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah. So usually instead of like,
usually
forward,
like talking or having a group, what we'll do is we just put a little star in the group and that means everyone will go to that page and comment, which I do have to tell them to, which I learned from Maggie, like four words, I guess, she was saying, to create, have that count as an engagement. But I am in four of those. So sometimes of how I find people like that, I just kind of stalk their Instagram and see if they are posting at least 2 times a day, and I do see them like come up on other comments. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I do stalk them out on the bigger pages, and whoever comments, I'll kind of stalk their pages and see how and see how their content is, and that's how I can find them.
Mm-hmm.
we'll start right here.
Are the, so most of your photos with all this dimension, is that multiple sessions or is it each one's different?
Say that again?
So you have all these photos on so much dimension, but most of those, are they multiple sessions or can you get that dimension?
I can get that in one.
Yeah?
Yep. So also too, so okay, so say for instance this one. If someone came in and they already have highlights in their hair, I can create more of a balayage effect in one sitting. So what I would do is, well, don't act like this is the, well, so what I'll do is I will have a shifting color, which is probably like a demi. So what I will actually do is, so I would paint one side, you know, go to the other side, and then what I will do is take a demi and only surface paint right in here with the darker color. Now, if she's a level A, I'm not gonna go down to a level 4. That's just gonna look like a mess, you know what I mean? So usually I'll do about 2 to 3 level difference and I'll just surface paint very lightly because you don't want the color to get inside. So that's where my tension is going to be huge. Even with the lightener, you don't want it to bruise into that and get the orange banding. So I will do that a lot if they want to either create, you know, low lights in the hair. Sometimes I'll just take panels and add the low lights. For the definition, I can actually show you how I kind of, after I'm done here, I can kind of show you how I do the back. If you're doing dimension in the hair, you don't want to do only a couple pieces and then leave a rest, some of them out, because you will be able to tell. So if I decided I was going to do that pancaking section for you, I've done it where maybe I'll do a little bit on the sides, you can tell. So if you're going to pancake, do it, you know, all the way around, because you're going to notice a big, huge, bold spot where it's going to kind of look kind of funky, okay? So this little front money piece, and then I'll get to the next person, so I'm not holding everybody up. But you can. It's really heavy because when you pull it, it won't topple over. There are some times where I guess other people have gotten it and it wasn't heavy on the bottom, so that's what you need to look for. But it's great. I'm not. What was that?
Why do you use a metal bowl?
It is stainless steel, so it doesn't have any interaction with it. And a lot of people ask that question. Don't ask me why. So I like to use, I mean, a lot of people use like a ceramic bowl. It looks a little bit nicer, I guess. It almost compares to like a fillet on a paper plate. So whatever, you know, you're using, it's a great service. I don't want to use a crappy stained color bowl because I'm providing something a little bit more luxurious. You know, they don't come in as often. You know, you kind of want to play the part up a little bit. So. Anytime I'm doing the front, I do like to elevate it. I do like to elevate it because when you bring it back down, it also disperses and gives it more of that melting effect. So this front piece here, I'm just gonna grab this pretty tight. I'm also going to show you one other trick after I'm done with this and how to, you know, if you get your hair tangled when you're balayaging, on how to kind of comb that out without changing with a comb.
I know.
Yeah, I do like it, and sometimes I have to tell my clients, oh wait, sorry, I'm not talking to you. I'm just like so into what I'm doing right now. Like, oh no, it's okay. But sometimes I just, you know, get in that zone. But see how thick that is though? You know, if you don't have, if you see all these, you know, processing pics online and you can see through the hair, either that client's gonna be waiting now or they're not gonna get light, or it's just not gonna lift as well. Or like I said, they're gonna be waiting an hour. I don't have time for that. So basically now that you see it, I mean, all in the back here is, you know, all surface painted, you know, so you can take the thicker sections you take, the more dimension you're gonna get and the more that front's gonna pop. So basically when she lays her hair down, I'm gonna mess this up, so. But when she wears her hair down, you know, you can style it however you want. If that's like pulled forward and she has a bang, when she curls that back, you're gonna see all that dimension there. So that's how you get that dark effect, you know, more on top, and that little money piece sticking out right there. All right, I want to show you one technique before I leave. This is Candy Shaw's technique. It's called shoestringing. So I'm just gonna take a random section for you guys. And this is good if, you know, you're playing with the hair, or if you have like a knot in there, and this is like a good way to get it out without like unraveling it totally. So she likes to use the expression, if you paint a knot, you're gonna get a spot, and that's kind of true. And I also like to use the termination, if it's not white, you're not gonna get light. Thin sections where you can see through it, because like I said, the product is really thick and it won't hold up to it. So basically, again, your surface painting. Okay, so what happens if like you have a little roughed up edge here? So what I like to do is you kind of go back and forth. See how that takes everything out?
Yeah.
Exactly. And then I kind of go back. You know, depending on if, you know, her hair, you know, tangles really quickly. Even in general too, like with someone who has really thick hair, you want to just make sure you're nice and even. Just kind of keep going back and forth, and it kind of evens all that out, so you know you're going to ensure nice consistency.
Yeah, I'll be breaking
the. That's it.